There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation, Jesus. There's a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us, Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the seas, who stands in the fire beside me. He roars like a lion, he bled as a lamb, he carries my healing in his hands, Jesus. There is a name I call in times of trouble. There is a song that comforts in the night. There is a voice that calms the storm that rages. He is Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me. He roars like a lion, he bled as a lamb, he carries my healing in his hands, Jesus. Messiah, my Savior, there is power in your name. You're my rock and my Redeemer. There is power in your name, in your name. You walk on the waters, you speak to the sea, you stand in the fire beside me. You roar like a lion, you bled as a lamb, you carry my healing in your hands. God, you walk on the waters, you speak to the sea, you stand in the fire beside me. You roar like a lion, you bled as a lamb, you carry my healing in your hands, Jesus. There is no one like you, Jesus. There is no one like you.
Amen. Welcome to the Journey Church. We're so glad that you've chosen to be with us here on this Sunday morning. At this time, let's go ahead and stand up, church. You know, I just want to share a little bit about Hannah and just our last week or so, very briefly. If you want the full story, there's a lengthy retelling of our last month or so of life on our Facebook page. Feel free to go there. If you don't have Facebook, I can share it with you in other ways. But yeah, she's doing well, as well as one can be after multiple surgeries and 2 liters of internal bleeding and losing about half of her blood volume. But she is at home now. She is resting. She's pretty much on full bed rest right now. Still a lot of pain, but as far as we can tell, it's just surgery-related pain and not internal bleeding or anything like that. But just want to say thank you so much to everyone that has prayed for us, that has brought us food, that's watched our babies, that's sent us cards and given us money and just all the amazing things that you all have done for us. We love you and we thank you so much. We cannot imagine doing life without our family and our church family. We consider you guys a part of our family, genuinely. I mean that. So thank you all, and let's, without further ado, let's get into our worship service, and let's praise our God together, church. Let's sing it out.
There is a habitation built by the living God for all of every nation who seek that grand abode. Oh, Zion, Zion, I long thy gates to see. Oh, lovely Zion, Zion, when shall I dwell in thee? A city with foundations, firm as the eternal throne, nor war nor desolations shall ever move a stone. Oh, Zion, Zion, I long thy gates to see. Oh, lovely Zion, Zion, when shall I dwell in thee? No night is there, no sorrow, no death and no decay, no yesterday, no morrow, but one eternal day. Oh, Zion, Zion, I long thy gates to see. Oh, lovely Zion, Zion, when shall I dwell in thee? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, singing Alleluia, Alleluia. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God, singing Alleluia, Alleluia. Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. Hallelujah. the deer pants for, the water so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength.
That's our prayer today, that we alone could worship you, that nothing else would take your place, that you would be the sole desire of our hearts, just as the deer pants for the water. Lord, so our souls long after you. We know that no one else can fill us the way you do. No one else can repair broken hearts. No one else could take our pain, our anger, our hurts. You alone, Lord, can make beautiful things out of us, broken people made from dust that you bring into beautiful life. God, you are our hope, and you alone. Pray this in Jesus' name.
Really? is springing up from this old ground. Out of chaos, life is being found in you. You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of the dust. You
praise you for making us new, from rising us out of the ashes. You alone, you are the miracle worker. You can take away our pain. You show us the way, Lord. We don't have to despair in this life. And we also don't have to hide from you, Lord. We don't have to try to hide our pain or our anger from you. God, we can bring all that to you. We can lay it at the foot of the cross. Our hurts, our frustrations. Lord, you want it all. You want our whole heart. Not just the good parts, not just the nice and tidy, clean parts that we show on the outside to everyone and tell everyone it's okay. But Lord, you want it all. You want our brokenness. And you want to make it new. We thank you for that. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated, church.
Good morning. Thank you, Corey, and to the worship team. That was a very moving worship service. We appreciate all you do to prepare. It's time now for our little ones. We've enjoyed having you here, but it's time for you to move back to Kids Journey, where you'll be learning about Jesus and our Heavenly Father as well. So now we have our scripture reading.
Good morning. This morning I will be reading from Acts 18, 1 through 26. After this, Paul left Athens and went to Corinth. There he met a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, who had recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had ordered all Jews to leave Rome. Paul went to see them, and because he was a tent maker, as they were, he stayed and worked with them. Every Sabbath he reasoned in the synagogue, trying to persuade Jews and Greeks. When Silas and Timothy came from Macedonia, Paul devoted himself exclusively to preaching, testifying to the Jews that Jesus was the Messiah. But when they opposed Paul and became abusive, he shook out his clothes in protest and said to them, "Your blood be on your own heads. I am innocent of it. From now on, I will go to the Gentiles." Then Paul left the synagogue and went next door to the house of Titius Justus, a worship of God. Crispus, the synagogue leader, and his entire house believed in the Lord, and many of the Corinthians who heard Paul believed and were baptized. One night the Lord spoke to Paul in a vision. "Do not be afraid. Keep on speaking. Do not be silent. For I am with you, and no one is going to attack and harm you, because I have many people in this city." So Paul stayed in Corinth for a year and a half, teaching them the word of God. While Gallio was proconsul of Achaia, the Jews of Corinth made a united attack on Paul and brought him to the place of judgment. "This man," they charged, "is persuading the people to worship God in ways contrary to the law." Just as Paul was about to speak, Gallio said to them, "If you Jews were making a complaint about some misdemeanor or serious crime, it would be reasonable for me to listen to you. But since it involves questions about words and names and your own law, settle the matter yourself. I will not be a judge of such things." So he drove them off. Then the crowd there turned on Sosthenes, the synagogue leader, and beat him in front of the proconsul, and Gallio showed no concern whatever. Paul stayed on in Corinth for some time. Then he left the brothers and sisters and sailed for Syria, accompanied by Priscilla and Aquila. Before he sailed, he had his hair cut off at Centuria because a vow he had taken. They arrived at Ephesus, where Paul left Priscilla and Aquila. He himself went into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. When they asked him to spend more time with them, he declined. But as he left, he promised, "I will come back if it is God's will." Then he set sail for Ephesus. When he landed in Caesarea, he went up to Jerusalem and greeted the church, and then went down to Antioch. After spending some time in Antioch, Paul set out from there and traveled from place to place throughout the region of Galatia and Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. Meanwhile, a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexander, came to Ephesus. He was a learned man with a thorough knowledge of the scriptures. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and he spoke with great fervor and taught about Jesus accurately, though he knew only the baptism of John. He began to speak boldly in the synagogue. When Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately.
All right, good morning.
Good morning.
And my name is Quinn Fields, and the title of today's sermon is Priscilla, Aquila, and Me, A Little Revolution Story. And we are continuing in the series of Revolution in Acts. So I want to thank Lexi and John Dickman for their sermons the last couple of weeks. John talking about breaking barriers and sharing a personal story about breaking barriers. And whenever we are able to expose ourselves to people that are different than us and new ideas. And Lexi talking about empathy that creates unity. And this idea that if we increase the amount of people, increase the circle of people that we consider on our team, then we can stay together and learn together. And so I'm going to kind of continue in that vein, hopefully today. We'll see if I accomplish that. And we are going to continue talking about this idea of revolution. And when you first think of revolution, you might think of the American Revolution. This might be an image that comes into your mind. You might think about what you learned in high school, in elementary school, about the American Revolution. You might think about the Boston Tea Party. You might think about the musical Hamilton, if you've seen that. Or you might think about the Love Revolution in the 60s. Woodstock. Was anybody here at Woodstock? No. Okay, nobody brave enough to admit it. Does anybody not know what Woodstock is? Okay, well, it's... maybe true, yeah. Well, if you don't know what it is, younger people, it's kind of like Coachella, but less Instagram, more other things going on there. And I don't know if Woodstock's really a revolution, but it's a kind of revolution, and I thought this picture was kind of cool, but a lot of times you learn about revolutions in class, in textbooks, and you learn about these big, larger forces going on, like taxation without representation or globalism or things like that, whatever kind of political terms you want to throw out there. But if you're like me, you enjoy these new documentaries that are coming out on Netflix and Hulu that gives you kind of behind-the-scenes story, smaller stories of why certain individuals join revolutions and key turning point moments in their lives. And we get one of these stories in the Book of Acts. But so, for instance, this lady that's on... Well, sorry to stay on that picture for a second. The lady that's on everybody's shoulders, for her, what was it that drove her to join this revolution that brought her there today? Was it the way she was raised? Was it, she just woke up one day and saw everybody else going down, and so she joined in? Or was it, reading The Catcher in the Rye in high school English class? So I think that's kind of interesting to think about, why each individual person within this larger revolution joins in, and what are those important moments in them? And we get one of those in the Book of Acts. Acts 18 that Sally just read for us. Thank you. And we see, I'm just going to talk about those verses 18 through 26, I believe it is, with Apollos and Priscilla and Aquila. And so Apollos was this charismatic, successful preacher. And we see from those verses that he was learned in the scriptures and that he was eloquent. And so he was a Jew from Alexandria, so he was, we can guess, a more recent convert to Christianity, but he was learned, and so he took it upon himself to share what he had learned from other people and got a spot in the synagogue to talk and got a lot of people to listen to him. And then afterwards, he was called by Priscilla and Aquila to their house, and they told him that they, we can imagine that they told him they probably liked a lot of what he was saying, and they affirmed him in some way, but they told him, he's missing something, that there was this bigger picture about the grace of God that he didn't even understand yet. So specifically, it talks about that he only knew the baptism of John. So they were telling him about the baptism of Jesus and that the grace of God is even bigger and more powerful than he had previously thought. And Apollos was a charismatic, successful preacher, like I said, and so he might not have wanted to listen to Priscilla and Aquila. Priscilla and Aquila were unexpected teachers because, for one, it was a couple, and in that time, I'm not sure how common it was for a man to listen to a woman's opinion on things such as theology. I'm not an expert, but I think, in this patriarchal society, that wasn't as common, and they were different. They were unexpected because they were people he was preaching to. He didn't go to hear from them. They were unexpected because they were strangers. It seems like, based on the text, that they didn't know each other beforehand. And they might not have had as big of a resume as Apollos. It says he was very learned in the scriptures, so he knew what he was doing. And Apollos is willing to listen to these unexpected teachers. So he's in the middle of this larger revolution of the book of Acts, and he's one of these revolutionaries. And he gets stopped, and he gets told that, you know, this revolution that you're a part of and that you're preaching and you're asking other people to join in on, there's something you don't get about it. It's there's something about the picture of the revolution, of the radical love of Jesus, that you don't get. And so they're pulling him a little bit closer to the heart of God in this revolution, the radical love. And it's a pretty cool story to see that, we don't get to see the exact conversation, but it's pretty cool that Apollos is willing to listen to these unexpected teachers. And when I think about charismatic leaders not listening to outside voices, I think about cult leaders. And when I think about cult leaders, I think about John Humphrey Noyes and the Oneida community. I did a small paper on them freshman year of college, so I find them really interesting. But John Humphrey Noyes was not unlike Apollos in some ways. He was learned in the scriptures. He went to Yale Divinity School. You know, one of the best of the best in terms of potential for learning and for biblical study. And John Humphrey Noyes got it in his head through study of scripture that Jesus had already came back in AD 70 at the destruction of the second temple, and that because of that, the kingdom of God had already came on earth. And since the kingdom of God had already came on earth, he now had the will of God, or we now as Christians have the will of God. And so he taught this idea of Christian perfectionism, that the only true Christians are perfect. And so because he had the will of God, everything he did, every impulse out of his body was the will of God. And if it sounds crazy, it is crazy. And it led to some crazy things that ended up happening with this community. And he was told by his professors, this is crazy. You need to rethink this. And he wasn't willing to. He wasn't willing to listen to these outside voices. And because of that, he started this own community, went out on his own, because he thought that he knew more. He thought he was learned enough. And eventually, basically, the Oneida community was this utilitarian society. It started in Vermont, and then they moved to Oneida in New York. And they ended up practicing some really weird things, like complex marriage. It's like everybody's married to everybody. Eugenics, which is basically human breeding. And in the end, his voice was the only voice that mattered, and he wasn't listening to any outside voices. And it led them down this path to this really weird and scary things happening. In the end, he basically shut down the society whenever he was going to be arrested for statutory rape. And you might have heard similar stories over the years of different cult communities. You might have watched like Wild Wild Country on Netflix and seen how these different, there are some out there groups like that. But this one I thought is fascinating because it actually came about inside the realm of Christianity. And so, and you might have seen individual churches where this has happened, where just one person has all this influence and they're not willing to listen to any of these outside voices. And so scary stuff happens, and a lot of times you get pulled away from the revolution of Jesus, of radical love. And so as church people, we're part of the same revolution that Apollos was a part of. And, you know, there wasn't just Pentecost happened and the Holy Spirit came down and that was the only thing that ever mattered, and everybody figured it out right then, what this following Jesus thing was all about. You know, it wasn't just Pentecost happened and that video was shared on YouTube, because there wasn't YouTube at the time, and then everybody just understood things the same way and followed Jesus in this perfect way, and once everybody figured out what it was all about. You know, there have been all these disagreements. In the book of Acts, sometimes we idealize it to think that everybody was on the same page. And we imagine the gospel just spreading like wildfire. But really, if we look a little closer, there are a lot of disagreements in the book of Acts, and especially if you read Paul's letters talking about some of the churches that are mentioned in the book of Acts, there are disagreements that happen. And it's not always a bad thing. Like Lexi was talking about last week, we can have these disagreements if we're willing to consider each other on the same team and listen. And so basically today, what I want us to think about is, who do we want to be as a church? Do we want to be a church like John Humphrey Noyes, that, you know, we believe that we're doing things the right way and we have the will of God and we're not listening to any outside voices? Or do we want to be like Apollos? And do we want to be willing to listen to unexpected teachers that might pull us a little bit closer to the heart of God and pull us a little bit closer to the revolution of radical love of Jesus? And I really don't have anything more profound than that to say, other than that idea that we can broaden our scope of people that we're willing to listen to, of people that we're willing to think might be able to teach us a little bit something about the heart of God and might be willing to pull us a little bit closer to the revolution of radical love. And so I'll give you a few examples just from my own life of some unexpected people that I've learned from. And maybe you are thinking of some in your own life, people that you've learned from that have been unexpected, that you didn't expect to teach you about Jesus, about the heart of God. And maybe there are people in your own life that you haven't listened to that maybe you should, or maybe you could. So for me, like Apollos, I thought of myself as fairly well-learned in the scriptures coming out of college. I knew I wasn't an expert, but I had got a Bible degree from Christian college. I had won an award for like outstanding potential in ministry and biblical understanding, something like that. I don't know, they gave me a big Bible. It was pretty cool. But once I got out of college, I started to learn a lot of things that I didn't fully get. And I started to get these clearer pictures of the heart of God. And since moving back to Tulsa, even the last 2 years, some of the people that have been unexpected teachers for me have been people that aren't even believers, that to me in some way have shown me a little bit more about the heart of God through their concern for things that I wasn't as aware of or focused on, like environmental justice and concern for animals and people that are on the margins, vulnerable people, and their concern and knowledge for these bigger systems that are in place that keep people vulnerable and that keep people in power and power. And so, you know, even though these people weren't people that I expected to teach me anything about Jesus, because they weren't even followers of Jesus, in some way they did. And they pulled me a little bit closer, I think, to this revolution of radical love that Jesus was all about in their own way. And another example of somebody that pulled me a little bit closer to the radical love of Jesus is a lady that I met when I worked at Bella Rose Senior Living. And there's a picture of, well, it's not that important of a picture, but it's just, it was a fancy place, a fancy senior living place, but you know, I was going there to serve the people and, you know, hopefully to show them some love and to show them what I thought was the heart of God. And then I ended up learning from a lot of them. And one lady specifically was a lady named Miss Lucille, who was in memory care. And she, for one, we just instantly connected. I instantly connected with her. And she just had this infectious joy and laughter. But the thing that I learned from Lucille was her generosity. And whether it was the way she was raised, or whether it was her faith, or just something in her, she could not do anything, she would not do anything completely for herself. We would go to Brahms, and she would measure out half of the ice cream cup, and she would scoop out half of the ice cream and eat it, and then she would show me half that was left and be like, this is yours, you have to eat the rest of this ice cream. And at that age, like, there was nothing that was, you know, she wasn't getting any perks from being super generous. It was just so ingrained in her, even with, you know, limited physical ability, limited cognitive ability at that point in her life. But she was so concerned that for everybody else in the room, that she was always wanting to share. And so she showed me a little bit about the heart of God that I didn't really fully get, and she pulled me a little bit closer to this revolution of radical love. And so I want us to think as a church, you know, who can we learn from? Who can we learn from that maybe we haven't considered teachers before? Who are potential teachers for us? And I want to give a key caveat here that, you know, when I say learn from, the first step there is listening, right? Apollos couldn't learn from Priscilla and Aquila if he didn't go to their house and listen to them first. And so listening and following are two different things. You know, we shouldn't be following every single new voice that we hear, because then we would just be going every single different direction that the wind blows. We would be like going crazy. And so just because you listen to a voice doesn't mean you have to follow them, okay? And also I'm talking about keeping an open mind about the revolution of radical love of Jesus. I'm not talking about keeping an open mind about every single crazy idea out there. Like, you don't have to listen to every single conspiracy theory. But we should be willing to listen to people that are different than us, people that have had different experiences than us, and people that might be able to teach us something about the heart of God. And so, young people, you might be thinking, do I really have to listen to these boomers that are stuck in their ways, or people, you know, older that are just don't know anything about me? Well, yes, I think you should listen to them. And I think that, you know, just like Priscilla and Aquila were unexpected teachers for Apollos, they might be unexpected teachers for you. And older people might be thinking, do I really have to learn from these young whippersnappers? And yes, I think you do. I think you should listen to them. And then once you've listened to them, it's up to you what you decide you will incorporate into your life, and what you decide is showing you some truth and pulling you a little bit closer to this revolution of radical love, and what you decide is maybe not. But if you don't listen, you'll never know, and you'll never have that opportunity to learn. And so, worship team, you can go ahead and come on up. So the closing prayer today, and after this, we'll have a time of response. And if you want to take that next step in Jesus, or if you want in following Jesus, or if you want to commit to following Jesus for the first time, have that opportunity, and the shepherds will be up here to pray with you. Closing prayer for today is, may God send us those who pull us closer to the revolution of radical love that Jesus proclaimed and enacted. And may God send us the courage to listen to new voices and old voices, and the wisdom to discern truth in what we hear.
Please stand with me as we sing. You are there.
great are yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one.
We come to a time when we're going to be taking communion with here. And when I come to this time, I really want to focus in on Jesus and what he's done for me. And I've heard the phrase, you know, we need Jesus needs to be drawn closer to us. And I think Jesus is as close as he can be to us. He died for us. He took our sins. So when I come now and we get to partake of the bread, there's his body and the juice of his blood, I think, how can I draw closer to Jesus? And that's really why it is so important to me and maybe to all of us that we don't just take it as something we do once a week. This is a time to really draw in closer to know Jesus and to let him just love on us. And that's why when I look at what he did, he didn't do it for people have great stature. He didn't do it for certain people. He did it for all of us. And that's why everybody's welcome here. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for your son, Jesus, the love that he gives to us, the love he is just is something we can't even wrap our heads around. But we know the love that he gives because we feel it in our own heart, and we know that it is real. And we just thank you, Father, that you allowed your son to come down here and die for our sins. And we thank you, Jesus, that you're willing to do that, and that the love that you had for us is so strong and so great that you would suffer for us. And as we come and we partake of the bread and the wine, we want to be drawn closer to you. We want to draw in so close to you that we can feel your heartbeat. And we just pray this in your name. Amen.
Salvation belongs to our God, who sits upon the throne, and unto the
praise, honor, and glory be to our God forever and ever and ever. And the church said,
amen.
Amen.
Well, we have come now to our family time. And so if you have little ones, first of all, this is the time to go retrieve them from Kids Journey. Also, during this time, we want to celebrate, we want to encourage one another and hear from one another. And we know some of you may have either some prayer requests, or maybe you've got an announcement, or maybe a praise report you want to share with the family. And if that's the case, if you will, if you'll come have a seat here on the front row so that we know that you're ready and set to go with us. You're also going to notice, if they've not already come by, there's going to be plates where we have our offering. And that offering really is to help support the work not only in this church, but the work around the world where God is working and moving. We want to help and contribute in that work. And, of course, we had our the books come around that help us to keep up with one another. And if you did not have an opportunity to put a prayer request in there, be sure and grab a book. And be sure that request gets to someone. We want to honor that with you. So is there anyone here in the meantime that has maybe a birthday, anniversary, any kind of shout out like that you want to shout out from where you are and let us celebrate with you? Yes.
Jamie's birthday will be Thursday.
Happy birthday to Jamie. That's awesome. Anyone else? Six. That's a big deal. Yes.
My
That's awesome. 27. Happy birthday to Micah. That's great. Yes. I love that. Happy birthday. Yes. Yes. Wow. That is a big deal. Congratulations. That is an inspiration for all of us to press on, right? That's great. Yes?
My dad's birthday Friday.
Awesome, Quinn. Is he here today? Oh, man. And you were the preacher today. Maybe that's a good thing, not to have to look at dad and mom while you're preaching. Anyone else? Okay, well, I know we have some announcements. Who wants to get us kicked off? You guys want to start?
Okay, so the youth group's envelope fundraiser is still ongoing. So if you would like to support our youth in their Sunday morning lessons, their events, or their upcoming summer trips, come see Nate or myself, get an envelope, and then return it back to either Nate or myself.
Awesome. And we've got some big news. So on Saturday, we are going to invite you all at 1:30 at the Outpost to kick off our kids. We're going to camp. And so come pray for them, pray over them. So come to that on Saturday if you're free. And then I guess the bigger news is that we're getting married. So.
Oh my goodness. Really? No kidding. Congratulations, you guys. That's so exciting. I guess that's all the news we're going to get about that today. That was a very short announcement about marriage. There will be more details to come, I'm sure. Yes. Christina, you have something? Or are you guys wanting to go last, or does it matter? Okay.
Okay, I know you all saw the goodies out in the hallway. Mm-hmm. Well, there's more goodies. And we've got the individual items that you can buy, and they're marked. And we're also going to have an auction, silent auction. The sign-up sheets are out there. Some of you have already signed up. And when we have our closing Lord's Prayer, I will set my phone for 10 minutes. And when that alarm goes off, the auction is over. So don't tarry too long. But you got to watch and make sure your name's the last one. That's important too. Let me tell you what we've got. We've got spinach dip. We've got fudge. We've got a fruit tray, beautiful fruit tray that has cherries and strawberries and grapes and pineapple. We have some banana pudding, and not your mama's banana pudding. This is a Paula Deen recipe that's supposed to be wonderful. And you didn't see it because it was in the fridge, but it'll be out there now. Now we've got some tray leches that Bartola made. It's authentic. It's a Honduran recipe and wonderful. We've got two of those, and they were in the fridge, will now be out there. We've got Linda Davis's blackberry cobblers, homegrown blackberries, two of them. We've got a Boston cream pie, looks wonderful. We've got two plates of two dozen chocolate chip cookies that Miss Jill made, and you know her chocolate chip cookies are world famous. And we've got a cookie brownie tray. And then last but not least, Bob Swikert's famous peanut brittle is gone. It's already gone. Robert's got one. However, Mr. Bob is going to make more. There's a sheet you can sign up on. You don't have to prepay. You can pay it either today or and we'll mark it paid, or you can pay it next week when he brings it. Some bags are pound bags. Was it a half a pound? Half a. But what's the small one? Okay, the smaller ones for a half a pound are $7, and the bigger bags are a pound and a half, and they're 20. Now, keep in mind, this is homemade peanut brittle, homegrown peanuts. I mean, you just can't get any better than that. So, you can sign up, and Bob will bring it next week. Now, I don't know what the farmers back here are laughing about, but... Yeah. Anyway, we got good stuff. It's fundraising for the kids to get to go to camp. So get your wallets out.
That's awesome.
Empty them.
So everybody do like this. Get the drool off your mouth, right? Right? And no stampeding, but move quickly when we're done. Okay.
I wanted to... announce that we have three of our members traveling back from mission fields today, Beth and Joe will arrive sometime late this evening, and Greg will get in tomorrow sometime. So I want to take this opportunity for us to lift them up in prayer. God. This is like herding wild goats.
I obviously didn't get the blue memo.
You didn't get the green one either. Dear Father in heaven, we come before you, or the whole congregation does, and we're praying for safety for our members that are traveling home from mission trip. And Father, when I think about this, I always think about the story where Jesus was going to go into the desert and fast for 40 days, and you sent a legion of angels with him. And so, Father, I pray that you put a legion of angels around each of these airplanes, and that with that hedge of protection, they will be safe. And Father, also for the Harding students that will remain, and for the lady that will be taking Greg's place, we continue to pray for their safety and protection also. And we lift this prayer up in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And also while we're here, for those that may not have heard, Jeff Sutton's mom passed away last night. And so please keep him in your prayers and pray for that family.
Yes. Thank you.
That's okay.
That's all right. Okay, I am up here to announce the meal train for Corey and Hannah. As you all know, Hannah has been having troubles with her operation, and she's home now, and she's doing okay, but she's still in a lot of pain. And they have a lot of dietary restrictions, so we can't just do a regular meal train to help out with food. So they're asking for gift cards. Thank you. I'm sorry, my brain. Two specific, vegan-friendly restaurants around town. I had a couple of friends already ask me, like, well, we wanted to get them a gift card, but they wanted an email address, but it was a little too complicated to know where to give them. But what you can do is you can just go to Walgreens or Walmart. They have those little kiosky areas to get a Subway gift card. I think Subway was on the list. And you can just get them $20 and bring it to them. You can bring them to the outpost. We could mail them their addresses on the meal train. But they can also use help with, like, running errands or childcare, or, you know, if somebody can go out and mow their lawn or weed eat or just anything, just kind of help them out, because she can't really get up and around. And I think he said something about just a couple minutes every couple hours is about all she can stand. So they just really need some help. And, you know, she's young, and I know it's killing her not to be able to take care of her little family. So we just really need to lift them up and take care of them like I know she would, and they would all take care of us if we needed them. So if you have any questions about the meal train or anything that you will be able to help out with us, just let me know or talk to Corey or anything. I'm in the directory, Christina Abley, just look me up.
That sounds good.
Thanks.
You can go ahead and hang out up here for a minute. Corey, why don't you come up? And anybody that wants to come pray with these guys, this is just such a difficult situation for this young family. If you want to come up, pray over Corey and in behalf for Hannah. And oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
You're going to stay here, right? Because I'm not going to pray. I'm not going to pray.
Would you like to pray?
Ooh.
Sorry.
You good?
Couldn't help myself.
Mike, would you pray?
Oh, I'd love to.
Thank you.
Holy Father, we are so thankful for Hannah and for Greg, or for, excuse me, you know who I'm talking about, Lord.
The other guy, Lord.
Corey. Yeah. Anyway, you know who I'm talking about here.
The bearded one.
And I'm thankful that you are in their lives right mm-hmm. now, and that you have been with those physicians there at the hospital that did their jobs, and that you are strengthening them through their inner core, through their physical, through their emotional, through their spiritual. Thank you for healing that comes from that, and thank you for everyone who is giving to them to help them through this kind of rough spot, because this is a tough spot. It's a frightening place to be. It's a frustrating place to be. And so, Father, I pray your peace will be upon them, and in such ways that it is inconceivable how we can see that occurring. We're thankful that you love us so much that you never leave us alone. Mm-hmm. Thank you for this family of people on whom we can rely when we need help. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Actually, love you guys. Thank you so much.
Well, we love you.
Actually, Corey, I know your name.
I know.
We love Greg too, but yeah. It wasn't Greg, all about Greg.
And thank you, Christina, for overseeing all of that. That's awesome. Well, now that we've kind of got through maybe the worst of the tornadoes and rain, of course, we have the church picnic rescheduled. It's for June 29. We're not going to go into details at this point, but just be sure it's on your calendar. We definitely want for you to be there. Is there anything else before we wrap up? Okay. Quinn, thank you. Awesome job today. We really appreciate that message. If you will, let's stand up, grab a hand across the aisle. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Thank you. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.